graduate and also your team for developing the general comment 37 to the International Covenant on Civic and Political Rights on persons, organizations' right to peacefully assemble. Could you tell us why, in the first place, you believe the general comment was so important at the start of this process?
Peaceful assemblies have brought about major changes in the world. It has also left deep scars when it was mismanaged by states and when it got out of hand. And so we wanted to make sure that the rules of the game, the rules of engagement, are stated more clearly, and that's what we try to do in the general comment. At the beginning, when we considered that we are going to draft the new general comment and we had to decide on the topic, we had inputs from civil society. So right from the start, civil society was very important. For myself as well, earlier I was the Special Rapporteur of the UN on Extrajudicial Summary Arbitrary Executions, and I worked with Maina Kiai. We were mandated by the Human Rights Council in 2016 to present a joint report on peaceful assemblies. And even in that process, we had global consultations. It was a three-year process. And before that, I also had a lot of inputs from civil society as Special Rapporteur. So civil society, I think, played a very important role in putting this issue on the table. And I think also what became clear to me is that with the challenges that the civil society space is facing, that the international community has a responsibility that we have to make sure that this is protected and that there are ways in which those who want to use it, that they say, well, there are international standards about this. And we had consultations in Geneva, in which we invited civil society twice at the beginning of the process in 2019, and again at the beginning of the second reading in 2020. But we also received something like 140 submissions from various stakeholders, including a very large contingent of civil society, in many cases dealing in a lot of detail on things such as the role of technology, on surveillance, on privacy, what are exactly the challenges that people are facing, online assemblies and so forth.
Well, states now, they made a concerted effort in controlling the funds received by civil society.
Yes.
And then also knowing, they want to know how these funds is being used. And in some situations, they can even level you have foreign agenda if you are receiving even foreign funds from outside. What compelled you to look at that aspect at the final stage of the committee drafting?
On the one hand, societies and states' ability to control their environment. At the same time, the fact that funds do come in from the outside is often used as a pretext to completely shut down any kind of civil action. And to strike that sort of balance, I think, is very important. I would say, frankly, when we did the first draft, I was not sure where to put this in and where to address it and how to strike the balance. But as we had these consultations, and where people were then able to identify what are the major issues, it became clear that this was one of them. So it's there, I think, paragraph 33, and we in principle said this is something which is then part of what the scope of the right extends to. Sometimes think of peaceful assembly as just that day when people assemble in the streets, or now with the recognition of online assembly while we are talking on Zoom or whatever the case may be. But it's much broader than that. And this particular document, the starting point is one of protecting freedom. And so it's as wide as possible. It says that whether it takes place indoors or outdoors, whether it takes place on public space or in private space, whether it takes place offline or online, all of that is covered. So in principle, we say that even the ability to fundraise and to obtain resources is protected. Otherwise, the right really doesn't mean much.
I can give you vivid examples, you know, of what has happened recently of our National Coalition for Human Rights Defenders in Tanzania. The government of Tanzania deemed it fit to force the funding all the accounts of the organization, most effective human rights organization in the country. And by doing so, also then asking the organization to explain from where they got this money and from what purpose. And 100% of the money which the organization have is the same source where the state of Tanzania gets some budgetary support. Thank you. Move to. As a member of the UN Human Rights Committee, you were also recently involved in developing the United Nations guidance on the use of less than lethal weapons, police enforcement, which complements the general comment. Why is it important to focus on less than lethal weapons and police tactics at this moment in history?
I think you're right. These documents should be seen together. They were actually released within 1 month from each other. And they represent, in a way, a restatement of the international and the UN standards that are applicable to peaceful assemblies. So in the case of less lethal weapons, it's also applicable to arrests and those sort of things outside the context of peaceful assemblies. But they are central, and these two documents together are pivotal in defining the rules of the game as far as peaceful assemblies are concerned. This is largely technology that developed after 1990, and so the availability of tasers and the availability of the kinds of tear gas that we have today and so forth, and the way in which it can be dispersed, all of that came afterwards. And so it became increasingly important that there will also be rules on that. So the general principles of necessity, proportionality, those things have been established, but what does it mean in practice when one is talking about a rubber-coated bullet or whatever the case may be?
Thank you so much. Member of the Rights Committee. And your outstanding leadership developing the general comment. It's a wonderful document that will support the global citizens to shape their future.
Thank you very much, Hassan.